song was right. We are here because of grace, the unmerited, unearned, undeserved favor of God on your life is the reason that you are here tonight. You probably thought you just decided to go to church. You're here because of God's grace and because God loves you. And because he loves you, he refuses to leave you the way that you were when he found you. And so we are going to, through the process of not only going through the book of James, but through the process of the rest of our lives, we are going to be changing, reforming, transforming more and more into the image of the Son of God. So you are his workmanship. Turn with me to James chapter 3. James has been a very practical book as we've been preaching through James. A very practical book for our lives. Truths here that we can apply daily in our walk with him. This evening we're in James chapter 3. The title of the message is Taming the Beast Within. Taming the Beast Within. Church, do you know what part of your body gets you in more trouble than any other? Kids, do you guys know? Is it your hands? Do your hands ever get you in trouble? When you take something from your brother or sister? Or when you hit them? Do you ever get in trouble for that? Yeah, I know these two on the front pew up here do. Callan's hiding his head. The thing that gets you in more trouble even than your hands is your mouth, right? Your tongue. What you say gets you in all kinds of trouble. And you need to realize, we all need to realize, that our tongue, our words, are powerful. From our mouth comes words that can either encourage, that can be helpful, words that can motivate, make people feel loved, or words that tear down, cause pain, can make people feel alone or unloved. I remember when I was a little guy, probably in third grade, we'd be at the bus stop, and there was a boy at the bus stop in our neighborhood, and he was a little slow. He had some mental issues, and he was a little slow in his speech. And so we'd make fun of him. Me and my friends, we'd gather around him and kind of pick on him and tease him, and we'd make fun of him because he was slow of speech. And I remember one day we were there at the bus stop early one morning. We started in on him, and he always would just kind of ignore us. But this one time, he turned to the four of us, and he said, "God's gonna punish you." And the four of us looked at him. It was the first time in my life that somebody had ever invoked the wrath of God on me as a personal punishment. And I was stunned as a little kid. But it made me think on that bus ride to school, well, what's God going to do to me? If I keep teasing this kid, what is God going to do to me? And it honestly terrified me. It frightened me the whole bus ride, and I thought about it. Now, later, me and Carlton became buddies. We became friends, and he used to hang out with us some in the neighborhood. But that was the point I'm trying to make is your words have power. Your words are powerful, and God equipped each one of us with the ability to communicate and to hear and understand communication for a purpose. Words have power. They have power to build up, and they have power to tear down. Words can change lives by God's design. So, the title of the message again is Taming the Beast Within. Let's go ahead and read our text here in James chapter 3. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, he is a perfect man, able to also bridle his whole body. If we put bits into the mouths of horses so that they obey us when we guide their whole bodies as well. Look at the ships also. Though they are so large and driven by strong winds, they are guided by very small rudder wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue is a small member, yet it boasts of great things. How great a forest is set ablaze by such a small fire. And the tongue is a fire, a world of unrighteousness. The tongue is set among our members, staining the whole body, setting on fire the entire course of life, and set on fire by hell. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile, of sea creature, can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. But no human being can tame the tongue. It is a restless evil, full of deadly poison. With it, we bless our Lord and Father, and with it, we curse people who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. Father, as we open your word this evening, as we try to glean and understand, we ask that your Spirit would give us understanding. Lord, that your Spirit would guide us and direct us into the truths that we need to apply to our lives, that we might be changed and transformed by them. Father, we thank you for the grace and mercy that you show us each day. We thank you for your forgiveness, for we all stumble in this area each and every day. Father, we thank and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so James opens the chapter with the statement, not many of you should become teachers. And it's interesting here, the word that James uses here for teachers is typically in the New Testament refers to a rabbi, a spiritual religious leader like a Pharisee, or a teacher in the New Testament church. Though it can really apply to anyone who holds the position as a teacher. So James is warning here those who seek the office of a teacher to first examine his own life, his walk with Christ, his heart's desire to serve the church rather than to serve himself, as was the practice of many of the teachers in the day when Jesus walked the earth. James didn't want the teachers in the church to model the Pharisees who taught oftentimes for self-aggrandizement, for selfish reasons. And so this comes right after the chapter. Notice in chapter 2 that James taught on faith without works is dead. Often, many of the teachers of the day had a lot to say, but their lives didn't reflect what they were saying. The things that they were teaching, they were not living them out. And so James warns, look, if any of you desires a position of teacher, know this, that the position of teacher will come with stricter judgment by God. And so James says, before you do that, examine yourself, your motives. Consider that God will hold you to a higher standard of scrutiny by what you say and what you teach to others. Earlier in James, James chapter 1 and verse 26, he gives a rebuke. He says, if anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Church, God takes his word seriously, and those who preach and teach his word ought to also take his word seriously. We are not to add to it, and we're not to take away from it. Deuteronomy chapter 18 and verse 20 gives this warning to the prophets of old who were there to proclaim God's word to the people. He says this, but the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name that I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of some other god, that prophet shall surely die. God takes his word serious. Because God's word is powerful. It is living. And for someone to corrupt it or change it for selfish gain, that is a serious sin against God. James is teaching us here that there is a direct relation between what a person says and how a person lives. Faith without works is dead, as we heard last week as Pastor Eric brought that message about faith without works is dead. And so how a person, what a person says and how a person lives has consequences. Now, that's not to say that teachers will be perfect in everything that they say. And so we need to recognize that there is only one who is perfect, and that is Jesus himself. And so James says here, for we all stumble in many ways, and if anyone does not stumble in what he says, then he's a perfect man. Now, if he can bridle his tongue, then he can control his entire body. So James is not saying that we are to be perfect. Only Jesus was perfect. What James is getting at is that you and I, if you and I can tame our tongues, control what we say and how we respond to what others say, then that is a sign of Christian maturity. That is one of the signs that the Spirit of God is at work in your heart, changing you from within. A regenerate heart is overflowing with righteousness. An unconverted heart is overflowing with unrighteousness. You see, it all begins in the heart and flows out from there through our mouths and the things that we say. You see, destructive words don't originate with our tongue or our voice box. Destructive words originate in the heart, that old nature of ours, that old sin nature that every believer still wrestles with. In Matthew 12, verses 33 through 37, Jesus says, actually, let's go ahead and turn there. Matthew 12, verses 33 through 37. Either make the tree good and its fruit good, or make the tree bad and its fruit bad. For the tree is known by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you speak good when you are evil? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The good person out of his good treasure brings forth good, and the evil person out of his evil treasure brings forth evil. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give an account for every careless word they speak. For by words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Church, these should be terrifying words to us when we consider how carelessly we use our words. If we look back on our lives, and I look all the way back to that time at the bus stop, how carelessly I used my words to hurt somebody else, and how many times I have done the same over the years since. This should be a terrifying passage of Scripture when Jesus says, by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Now we know that for those who have received Jesus Christ, we've been given a new nature. That old nature has passed away and all things have become new. That old man. And evidence of that, some of the first evidence of that is in our speech. I remember as a teenager, Tammy can attest to this. I remember as a teenager how much profanity I would use. Now, I wouldn't use it around my parents or Tammy's parents, but I would use it hanging out with my friends. And I remember after conversion, you guys remember the knock on the door I got that one night with those two little ladies and the whole deal, right? And I received Christ that night. But it wasn't long after that I noticed something. I wasn't using those words as frequently as I used to. And it's not because I'd stop myself and say, wait a minute, now that I'm a Christian, I can't use these words. It's that they just weren't there anymore. You see, the source had changed from the corrupt, sinful heart to the new heart. And over time, we will see that in our lives, not just in our speech, but we should see behaviors and thought patterns and habits begin to change as we grow and mature in our faith in Christ. So one of the signs that you have truly been saved regenerate, your heart has been made anew, one of the signs in your life is that these things will change. Your speech will change. Your attitudes will change. Some of your habits and actions, the way that you respond to others will change over the course of your life. You see, words express thoughts and feelings. Words don't come out of anywhere, right? Words are an expression of the things that we think about and the things that we feel. And so as we express words, they're a reflection of our nature. If we still have a fallen nature, if we are outside of Christ and we have not been regenerate, we have not been born again, then everything that flows from that person is going to be from that old sinful nature. The opposite is also true. Those who have been converted, their source of those words, their heart has been changed. So for the unconverted person, we often find people that speak gossip, for example. They speak slander against other people. They're backbiters. They have outbursts of anger. They boast. They're proud. They tell lies. They curse others. They complain. They manipulate. They discourage. For those who have a changed heart, a heart that is now has a desire for God and for righteousness, that person compliments, encourages, express affection for others, builds others up, is honest, praising others, honoring others and God, showing gratitude. See, these are the expressions of a heart that's been changed. There's some examples in Psalms and Proverbs. Psalm 34:13 says, "Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit." Proverbs 15:1-2, "A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. The tongue of the wise brings knowledge, but the mouths of a fool pour out folly," or foolishness. Proverbs 15:28, "The heart of the righteous ponders the answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things." Notice how the writers interchange the words tongue, lips, and mouth with the word heart. Listen to what he says. "Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. The tongue of the wise brings knowledge, but the mouth of a fool pours out folly. The heart of the righteous ponders how to answer, but the mouth of the wicked pours out evil things." You see, the psalmist and the Proverbs, they express how these words that we speak emanate from our nature, from our heart. Remember, Jesus gave us the example of the good tree produces good fruit, and the bad tree produces bad fruit. So the question is, what is in the root? Where are the roots grounded in your life? Are the roots grounded in a good heart that has been converted and changed, that wants to please God, that wants to express love and compassion to others? Or is your heart still rooted in an evil old nature that has not yet been changed? And therefore, from that, only bad fruit is produced. The tongue, you see, church, is difficult to tame, but it is merely an amplifier, like this microphone and these speakers, merely an amplifier of the heart. So you can see the heart of a person by what comes out of them, by the words that they speak. The question of taming the tongue or controlling speech cannot be fixed with some kind of proper grammar lesson. Now, don't say these words. These are bad words, and you can only say these good words. Okay? A grammar lesson or a lesson in etiquette is not going to change the heart. James gives us three examples here in our text in verses 3 and 4. One is of the horse and the bridle. Oh, there he is. Now you see how that bridle, see where the bridle, the bit goes? Where does it go? In the horse's mouth. Actually, it goes right over the tongue, interestingly enough. And that little bit, and that little bridle, controls the entire horse. So if you pull on those two reins, the horse will turn his head and his whole body will follow. So James has given us this example. That big, powerful horse can be controlled by that little bit that's in its mouth. He also gives us an example of a ship and a rudder. A ship and a rudder. So you see this large ship and you see that rudder sticking down there in the back. And so wherever the captain wants this large ship, this large freighter ship to go, he can turn a wheel which will turn the rudder, and he can steer this large vessel wherever he wants it to go. Such a small rudder, James says, yet can turn such a large ship. And then lastly, it was a spark. James says that there's a spark, a small spark can ignite an entire forest fire. This one's interesting because this analogy of a spark igniting a huge forest fire is different than the first two because of the destructive force of a fire. It starts with a little spark, and that spark begins to consume everything around it. You guys know that back in 1871, there was a fire called the Chicago Fire. This was a fire that was started, by the way, by a cow in a barn kicking over a lantern. And that lantern caught hay on fire, and the barn went up, and guess what? 17,000 buildings burned because of such a small spark. 17,000 buildings, over 250 people lost their lives, and over 100,000 people were homeless because of such a small spark that started such a large blaze. In 2008, California wildfires burned over 1.3 million acres because somebody left their campfire unattended and a spark landed in some pine needles, and 1.3 million acres were burned up. Such a small thing seems to be very insignificant, but once it takes hold, once it starts to burn, the destruction is massive. In the same way, our words can be destructive. Our words can cause damage and devastation. Sometimes it's even multi-generational devastation, where there's an abusive parent that abuses their children verbally, and then they in turn abuse their children verbally. Multi-generationally, and that can impact many, many people. And so, church, our tongues are powerful weapons that can be used to harm, or incredible tools that can be used to help and heal. And that's what God wants us to use our mouths for, helping and healing, expressing love and encouragement to others. You see, man's capacity to cause damage and destruction by our words is incalculable. Do you know that every major war that has ever taken place began with words that were spoken? Disagreements turned to arguments, turned to physical confrontation that has killed millions upon millions over the centuries. Your words will steer the direction of your relationships, of your friendships, of your conflicts, of your employment. Your words will steer the direction of your life. So guard them well. Guard your words, because they are powerful. Listen to how David the psalmist describes an experience that he had in Psalm 57:4. David says, "My soul is in the midst of lions. I lie down amid fiery beasts, the children of man whose teeth are spears and arrows, whose tongues are like sharp swords." He was surrounded by enemies, And he said, I am laying down here. I am among lions. These men whose teeth and whose mouths and whose words are like sharp swords piercing my soul. Tongues are used as weapons by people to cause harm, to abuse, to control, to tear down. But look here in verse 7. Back in James chapter 3 and verse 7, look what he says. For every kind of beast and bird, of reptile and sea creature can be tamed and has been tamed by mankind. Dogs, tigers and birds and killer whales, all of them have been tamed by man. Isn't it amazing that God back in Genesis says you will take dominion over the creatures of the sea and over the birds of the air? You'll have dominion over these creatures, and yes, we have. Every creature on the earth, man can take dominion over except our own tongues. Wouldn't it be amazing if we took enough time to tame our own tongues as these trainers take to tame a bird or a killer whale or a dog or a tiger? But most of us ignore this aspect of self-control. James says, all of these animals and creatures can be tamed, but no human being can tame the tongue. In other words, left to yourself, you will not be able to tame your tongue. Only the power of God through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit will give you the strength to be able to tame your tongue. Only a heart that has been changed, the source of the words has to change before the words themselves will change. As Christians, we are to be controlled by the Spirit. Paul admonishes us to do that in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. Listen to what he says. But I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things that you want to do. See, there is a battle going on internally in all of our lives, a battle of between that old sin nature that wants to just be selfish and just, you know, do what it wants to do, and the new nature that God has given us, that we are to live and walk in Christ, that wants to honor God and love God and worship God. This internal war rages on. The new nature seeking to please, obey, and worship God, and that old nature that seeks to please self, satisfy self, and worship self. This is the battle that rages on. So how can it be that we praise God, James says, how can it be that we praise God, our Father and Lord, and with the same mouth we curse, we slander, we gossip about people that were made in his likeness, that he created? James says this ought not be so among God's people. Among God's people, we should not treat others that way. And so that's what James is getting at here in verse 10. He says, from the same mouth come blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not be so. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening both fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree, my brothers, bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? Neither can a salt pond yield fresh water. And so James is saying here, this ought not be so, that as you grow and as you mature in your faith, you should begin to overcome some of these battles in your walk with Christ. In verses 11 and 12, James gives us these examples of these two rhetorical questions. Does a spring pour forth from the same opening fresh and salt water? Can a fig tree bear olives, or a grapevine produce figs? The answer, of course, is obviously no. The fresh water and salt water cannot come from the same source. The source is different for both of them. Likewise, olives and grapes come from a different plant, a completely different source. Likewise, the source of the produce, the figs and the olives, is different. And in the same way, the salt water and the fresh water are different. In the same way, the church, the source of what we say, what we speak, the source of profanity and gossip and slander is different than the source from praise and blessing and encouragement. One coming from the old nature, the other coming from the new nature. So, church, if you struggle in this area, if the tongue is an area that you continually struggle with, there's a couple things that you need to do. First, examine, have I truly been saved? Am I truly born again? Do I have that new heart, that new nature, that new source that righteousness flows from? Or do I still have that old nature? Is the reason I struggle so much with my mouth is because the source of what comes out is still corrupt? If you have been born again, if you do have a converted new heart, then we have to ask yourself, am I exercising self-control? Am I yielding to the Holy Spirit? Do I feel conviction when I use profanity or when I gossip about somebody? Does the Holy Spirit convict me? And if he does, then we need to yield ourselves to the conviction of the Holy Spirit and ask God to help us in our struggle with what we say. Help us to tame that beast within. Let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer as we close out. Father, it is a struggle for each of us. The things that we say are a reflection of what is going on internally with us, a reflection of our heart. And so, God, I just pray that for those who maybe haven't come to faith in Christ, that they would humble themselves, repent of their sin, and trust Jesus as their Savior, acknowledging that Jesus was born of a virgin, that he led a perfect life, that he fulfilled all the requirements of the law of God. He was betrayed, nailed to a cross. He died as a substitute for you and I, taking the punishment that we deserve, satisfying the wrath of God. And for all who put their faith in him and trust in his substitutionary atonement, that they would be granted eternal life, that God would change their heart, call them a child of God. And for those who have been converted, that struggle with the tongue, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would bring great conviction, that they would yield to the leading of your Spirit, and they would guard their tongue, that they would be slow to speak, that they would not lash out and let their emotions control them, but be controlled by the Spirit. Father, we thank you that you have given us your Word and your Spirit to help us in our daily walk and daily struggle, daily fight against sin. We also thank you for your great forgiveness that you offer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, amen, church. This time we are going to partake of the Lord's Supper together. And so the Lord's Supper is for believers. And so if you haven't come to faith in Christ yet, we had asked that you would abstain from partaking of the Lord's Supper. Parents, you be the... You determine for your own families and your own children if they are ready to partake of the Lord's Supper. So how we're going to do it is we're just going to do it by family. And so if we can get the first, let's just get these first three rows, the Dawson crew, to come on forward. Take the elements and then take them back to your seat. And then once everybody's been served their elements, then we'll partake of the Lord's Supper together as the body of Christ. All right, Sumners, I think you're up. All right, back row. Thank you. All right, front row, you guys want to come on up? Oh, sorry, I'm zoning out here, pulling up stuff. All right, Lemire's, you're up. All right, Ayala's, you're next. Come on now. All right, last few, come on forward. First Corinthians chapter 11, we read, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" And so the Lord's Supper symbolizes the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Father, as we hold this bread, we recognize that Jesus' body was sinless and perfect. His body was nailed to a cross, was given as he laid down his life for those who would believe in him. Father, we thank you for his sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Take and eat. And this cup, symbolizing the blood of Jesus Christ that was poured out, his sinless blood, that was given as a final sacrifice, as the Old Testament priests slaughtered lambs and goats and bulls for a temporary remission of the sins of the people. Jesus came as a final sacrifice, that his blood would be shed once and for all, covering the sin of all those who would put their faith in him. We thank you and praise you for your sacrifice for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Take and drink. Okay, we're going to sing one final hymn. If you would stand. Let me pray for our blessing. You can, if you have an offering that you'd like to leave here, you can drop it off in the box in the back, or you can go onto our website. Click on the give button and give that way. Let's go ahead and pray for our offering. Father, through this whole pandemic, you have proven to be faithful to your people. There are many right now without work, struggling financially, but through it all, you've remained faithful to provide for our needs. We thank you for giving to us above and beyond what we deserve. And Lord, now we want to give back a portion of that that you have blessed us with, that your kingdom and your gospel might go forth. In Jesus' name, amen.
mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend. The agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son. You drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. By your perfect sacrifice, I've been brought near. Your enemy, you've made your friend. Pouring out the riches of your glorious grace, your mercy and your kindness know no end. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you.
Sing that again.
Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once you're in a your table, Jesus, thank you. I've washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once you're in me, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. Jesus, thank you.